I got a story to tell you. I had moved to Santa Cruz, California, and I got thrown out of the last commercial gym. And there were only three or four in Santa Cruz. And over a period of about 2 years, I'd earned my removal to the last commercial gym in Santa Cruz. And it was a very natural process. All you have to do as a trainer is dominate the local culture, the local environment within a gym, and take the clients from all the other trainers, and your days are numbered, you're about done. What happened was, I didn't have anywhere to go. And a friend of mine, a client who is a jiu-jitsu instructor with a jiu-jitsu school, he says, they hate you because you're the best. And that's okay. You come work with me and we'll keep going. So I got 150 square feet of dedicated space in a jiu-jitsu school. And I took my clients over there, and it was just an amazing experience. I'd freed myself from the Gold's Gym structure, and here I was working with a jiu-jitsu friend, and I got a space about like that, and God, I felt like I was a businessman all of a sudden. After about a year of being in the jiu-jitsu school, we went out and got our own gym, first box ever. And it was 1,250 square feet, roll-up door in a research park in Santa Cruz. And I wasn't part of someone else's business, but I had my own business. And I said, well, you know what? I don't know anything about business, nothing. So I better go to the bookstore. And there wasn't one book on the shelf, not one, that told me how to improve my product or service. They weren't even about that. And so here I'm in the business section of the bookstore, and these don't seem like business books to me. Because my instincts are I want to have the best training program on earth. Who can help me make it better? There was nothing in the books that had any bearing on that at all. So I started thinking, well, geez, how are we going to do this? Let's roll the clock forward a few months. We outgrew that space of 1,250 square feet. It took about 4 or 5 months. And I had a problem. I had an overcrowding issue. So we started looking at expanding. Well, that made me nervous. I was going to double or triple my rent. Can I do that? So I started making a checklist of all the reasons to expand, pros and cons, just like you want to do. And I'd look at that list. And it might be that in the morning when I had a lot of energy and a lot of enthusiasm, I'd look at the pros and cons, and it was clearly on the side of the pros. This is, you gotta do this, it makes sense, it makes good business sense. If I'd find myself a little later in the day, a little bit tired, mood would be beaten down, I'd look at the list and a bunch of the stuff in the pros seemed now like it would be in the cons, like maybe that won't happen. And I found that. And what am I trying to do? I'm trying to be a businessman. What does that mean? I'd forgotten this instinct of mine to just make the program better. What I was doing, my checklist was really about: will this work financially? Is this a good business decision? And the mindset was that business is about making money. Because if you can't pay the rent, you won't be in business. But then it hit me in just a blinding flash. Wait a minute! I'm not trying to make money. Money's what happens when you do something right. And so, this was the insight. There's the money. Over here we have excellence. All of my thoughts about money seemed to miss the mark, or it was just, there was no consistency to it. I couldn't come up with a plan that, yeah, this will work, I know it will. But I looked at excellence. So throw away the checklist. The gym expansion, will it be good for clients? Forget for a moment all the monetary considerations. And it was, God, we can get mountain bikes? Would that be good? No, that would be great. We can hang more ropes. We can get more rowers. We could, and I just had a big long list of things, and it was gonna make a salient, powerful difference for the clientele. And the list didn't waver. And when we did those things, we did, all of our clientele go, this is excellent, this is fantastic, here's what we were seeing. Excellence is obvious to everyone. It's just that easy. That first gym was really, really good. It was the best gym the world had ever seen. A friend called me up and said, friend in Seattle, he said, we want to be an affiliate. I said, that's awesome. What's an affiliate? I'm a trainer, right? I encourage dreams. This guy wants to be an affiliate. Tell me about it, this affiliate thing. He says, we want to be a CrossFit gym. I said, oh, shit. That's fantastic. Let's do it. He goes, cool. He goes, but I'm going to use the name CrossFit. And I go, okay, go ahead. He says, well, I think I should, you'd want something for that, right? I said, yeah, like $500 a year. You got a deal. Then T.J. Cooper, who is in the sheriff's office here in Jacksonville, he called up. And he says, I want to be one too. I'm going to do that affiliate thing. I go, it costs $500 every year. But I'll waive your fees because you're one of the early ones. So that the first one was CrossFit North. TJ became CrossFit East. I said, this is incredible. There's probably going to be five someday. North, South, East, and West, and us. We'll be headquarters. How you see the business genius? It's amazing. Early on, they wanted us to tell them what to do. We said, we've told you what to do. We showed you. You train like this. What time should we unlock the doors? Like, I don't know, well, before your first client gets there. When do I go home at night? When the last client's left and you've cleaned the place. What about an accounting system? I said, I don't know anything about that. The clients put their checks in the drawer, and when it starts filling up, I take them to the bank. I don't have that answer. But I do understand excellence, and I know when you're doing a good job training, and you will too. I believe that business is the art and science of providing uniquely attractive opportunities for other people. Business is the art and science of providing uniquely attractive opportunities for other people. That's what we've done. That's it. Nothing else. And we got 5,000 gyms. We're picking up about 15 to 20 a week right now. And these are small businesses with a 95% survival rate at the 5-year mark. It's unprecedented. All that's at play here is free market principles. They did take from us a very strong training idea. But remember, that idea languished in its current form for 20 years with out to 3 figures, zero growth. What happened was that this idea was given to the world. And anyone who wants to, you can do it. You could take the physiological model, the training stimulus that is CrossFit, and you could open up a gym and you'd have all the success in the world, and you don't have to give me anything. None of the methods, none of the concepts, none of it's protected. The only thing we protect is the name. But what the name represents now is this assemblage, this crew of 5,000 affiliates, 50,000 trainers, and we've gotten pretty good penetration in the world. And we've got some of you in here now. Some of us are you. Our estimate is that the CrossFit ecosystem is about $1 billion. That is the total financial take of all the trainers, of all the gyms. And our chunk of this is about 24 degrees of 360, or about 50 mil. And as this grows, what we're going to do is we're going to have this arc section diminish. When I was the only CrossFit trainer, I was taking 100%. When CrossFit North opened up, I lost some of the market share. And in fact, this slice of the pie that is within our control is narrowing, and by design, because the circle is growing, and it's growing rapidly. At about 50% a year currently. At about 50% a year. We call this the leased rents model. I am not interested in the activity that sits out here. It doesn't belong to us. It belongs to other people. Our job is to force these boundaries out to make the circle bigger for everyone while our section narrows. And we have to do that. We have legal authority, we own the name, but we have moral authority in that we speak for the affiliates and we will defend them to the end of the world. The private equity and the venture capital that have approached us, and we deal all day long currently with private equity and venture capital. What they want to see me do is this. They want us to take a bigger chunk. And we know that that would shrink the circle. Might make me wealthy. I had someone from private equity sit down with me and tell me, you should be a billionaire. I said, yeah, why is that? He says, it's all the money you're leaving on the table. I said, the money we're leaving on the table is an opportunity for other people. Let me give you one for instance. There's an outfit called Rogue. They're in Columbus, Ohio. They make CrossFit gear. They make equipment for CrossFitters. They'll probably do $60 million this year. Now, I could help myself to some of that by requiring that affiliates use CrossFit branded gear. And then Rogue would have a real problem. I don't want to own Rogue. I don't want to step outside of our core competency. I don't want to lose the moral authority. I'm not trying to make money. I'm trying to grow a community. I'm trying to support a community. This approach to widen the bandwidth, widen the arc sector, get more for yourself with no regard for the community, it's rent seeking. And I got a big issue with it. And I understand now that this you are here and the excellence, what we were chasing is value, wealth creation. And I have a real problem with any business activity that isn't about value creation. Money is essential to run a business. But it's not why you run a business, and it's not what makes a business grow. Businesses grow on dreams. Trying to make money is no way to run a business.
Thank you.